Greetings, welcome to the shop. So last time we cut this marquetry picture on a laser. Now lasers are cool and it can be a lot of fun bringing new technology to old school techniques, but some people like a little more hands-on. So this time we're going to cut the same design using the scroll saw and the double bevel marquetry technique. What is double bevel, you ask? Let me show you. So let's imagine we have one sheet of veneer that's our picture, and one sheet of veneer that we're going to add to the picture. So now we make our cut. So now we're keeping these pieces and throwing away those pieces. But what we notice is that the saw blade removes material. This is called kerf. So when the top piece drops into the picture, there's a gap around it the size of the saw blade. But with the double bevel technique, we can cut two pieces of veneer and remove the gap. So we start again with the veneer that's our picture, and we add the piece of veneer that we're going to add to the picture. So now we make our cuts at an angle, and again we're going to keep these pieces and discard these pieces. And what we notice when we drop the top piece into the picture is that the edges line up and there's no gap. And that's the magic of double bevel marquetry. So we can also cut it the other way, where the picture is on the top and the piece we're adding to the picture is on the bottom, and we'll talk about that in a minute. So what we need to know then is, what is the angle of this cut? So the angle of the cut depends on the thickness of the veneer and the size of the blade. Now there's a mathematical formula for this, but it's easiest to just make a few test cuts changing the angle until you get the fit you want. So let's do that. So we've got a couple of test pieces of veneer here. We're just going to tape these together and we'll cut some shapes into this at various angles and check our fit. Let's just do a little range. Let's start with, say, 7 degrees. Maybe 12 degrees and 16 degrees. And we'll have to poke a hole to start each one. So the teeth on these blades can be hard to see, so an easy way to tell the direction they're going is to just run your thumb across it. It'll slide when you're going along the teeth, and it'll catch when you're going against the teeth. And that's the direction you want to go down. You also want to double check that your teeth are pointing forward. You'll find it won't cut very well if they're pointing backward. All right, let's start with 7 degrees. We just thread the blade through the bottom. And now, because the head is tilted to the left, we want to cut counterclockwise around the design, keeping this piece that's going to drop down on the right side of the blade. And you don't have to follow any lines exactly. The piece is going to fit. Now we're going to set the angle to 12 and make that cut. And finally, 16 degrees. All right, so we've got our packet, and each of the circle-ish shapes we've cut. Let's untape the packet. And the maple pieces will drop into the walnut piece. All right, so I don't know how well this is going to work, but if you hold it up to the light, you can see this, which is our 7 degrees. Should see quite a bit of light coming around it. The gap is pretty large. The middle one at 12 degrees is a little better, and the 16 degrees is even better. There's a couple of gaps that I think were just from my cutting technique, but we're going to use around 16 degrees. So the other variable at play here is the direction of the cut. And this is going to determine whether we're adding the piece of veneer on top to the picture that's on the bottom, or if we're adding the piece of veneer on the bottom to the picture that's on the top. So we've got our little test sheets here again, two veneers taped together. Now if we make the cut counterclockwise on the circle, the bevel angles will be going like this. And this means we're adding the top piece of veneer to the picture on the bottom. But if we flip it around and we make the cut clockwise around this circle, the bevel angles are going like this. And that means we'll be adding the piece of veneer on the bottom to the picture on the top. I learned a really cool technique to visualize all of this from Scott Grove. He used a salsa cup, but any cup with angled sides will do the trick. Okay, so the first thing to note, of course, is that I have my blade tilted to the left. If you have a saw where the table tilts, your table will be tilted to the right. Now, you can do this the other way around, tilt the blade to the right or the table to the left, and everything just works the opposite. Okay, so the thing with this visualization is that the angle of the cup really makes it easy to see what's going on. So if you match the angle of the cup to the angle of the blade, we can see that in this instance, we're moving the piece from the bottom into the picture on the top. Now, if we're cutting the other direction, we flip the cup over to match the angle of the blade. And there we can see that we're moving the piece on the top into the picture on the bottom. Now, there are different reasons you might want to cut one way or the other, but the most important reason to keep track of this is that if you cut it the wrong way, it's not going to fit. So now let's go over all the materials we need for this project. And so we've got the drawing, which is reversed. We'll be working from the back side and taping on the front side, so a reverse drawing makes it a little easier to follow along. Got some tracing paper, some carbon paper, and of course some veneer. It's for the background, it's for the stems and leaves, it's for the flower petals. Some masking tape. You can use traditional veneer tape, but masking tape's a little easier. Got a pencil, scalpel or an X-Acto blade. We've got this little poker tool, which is just a hand drill with the end of a thumbtack stuck into it. And we use this for poking through the veneer to thread the saw blade rather than drilling, which removes material. A seam roller is pretty useful and a straight edge for cutting the veneer. And of course we'll need a scroll saw and some blades. And the only requirement for the scroll saw is that it has to be able to cut at an angle. So you either need one with a tilting head, like this one, or one with a tilting table, like this one. As far as blades go, I'm using a 2/0 skip tooth blade, and that works pretty well. So now I think we're ready to get started. So the first thing we want to do is get our drawing onto the tracing paper. So I was able to print right onto this tracing paper, but if your design is not digital, or you don't have a printer, then grab your pencil, you're going old school. So I also wrote the word up on my tracing paper, just to make sure that I've always got the correct side facing up. So there's generally two ways you can approach things. You can cut each piece into the background individually, or you can build up several pieces as a unit and cut those into the background. For demonstration, I think we'll cut the leaves and stem directly into the background, and then we'll build up the flower head as its own unit and cut that into the background as a whole. All right, so one of the first things I like to do is add some registration marks to the tracing paper. And this will just help with aligning everything on the background. So we'll transfer those to the background with the carbon paper. So we get our piece lined up where we want it. Slide some carbon paper under it and trace over our registration marks. Or you could have just drawn them in the first place with the carbon paper. So now whenever we need to line our tracing back up with our background, we have two registration marks to do so. Okay, so let's first start by cutting this piece, this little piece of leaf, into the background. So the way you do that is you line up your registration marks again. And we can slide our veneer underneath and get the grain lined up exactly how we want. And we can add a piece of tape just to hold it in place. Slide the carbon paper in, trace around what we're going to cut. And we can add some more tape to make sure everything is secure. And the way we're going to cut this is we don't have to cut exactly on this line or this line or even this line, because these pieces are going to be cut in later. The only thing that needs to be exact is this line. So we're going to cut extra material out kind of like this. So then when we cut in these other pieces, those lines will be defined. Generally, you want to try avoiding cutting over the same line twice. You can, but the more times you cut over the same line, the more likely you are to end up with something that doesn't look as good. All right, so let's go to the saw and make the cut. And since our bottom is the picture and the top is the piece we're cutting into the picture, we're going to move counterclockwise around this cut. Now we just take off the tape, and this piece will slide right into that hole. And then we'll tape it from the other side. So now as you'll cut, you'll build up these layers of tape. And sometimes what I'll do if there's a lot of pieces and a lot of tape is I'll go apply a layer of tape to here so that everything holds together, remove all this tape, and just apply a nice smooth single layer. So now let's go ahead and cut in this larger leaf here. So again, we'll line up our registration, and then at this point you also have the aid of all of the other pieces that you've cut into that point. And so kind of our method of attack here is going to be, we have to stay on this line exactly all through here, but then down in here we can come off and meet up with that bottom part. So another nice thing about this technique is if you venture off your line, it's okay, everything's still going to fit together because you're cutting the piece and the hole at the same time. Now you will accumulate quite the pile of masking tape. Don't throw it away yet. Sometimes a little piece will get lost and you'll find it stuck to a sheet of tape. So now I'm just going to continue on. I'm going to do this small piece and this side as a single piece next, and then I'll do the stem. And then when we come back, I will start on the head of the flower. So now let's move on to the flower. We'll build that up as a unit and then cut it into the background. So it doesn't matter too much where we start. So let's start with this piece and then we'll add this piece that goes behind it. So the first thing we'll do is just trace this piece onto the veneer. Now we'll cut in, let's cut in from the bottom just to kind of show that. So what we're gonna do is kind of get the grain going how we want it. I think straight up and down is pretty good. And we're just going to come in here, follow this line, and come out here. And then that'll join those two pieces together. So now these pieces fit together. And we can line this back up and retrace that line onto the new piece. All right, so let's just move on to this part. So we'll do the same thing and we'll make a cut that's gonna come in and hit this line. Then it's got to hit this line, and then it can come out. So another thing you might notice is I get my fingers pretty close to the blade. These small blades aren't going to really cut you. It'll kind of burn maybe if you hit it, but you also want to kind of hold the veneer down, otherwise it'll start ripping apart. All right, so now hopefully you can kind of see how we're going to proceed to build this up. And we're always going to make sure that we've got material around the outline so that way we can cut everything into the background when we're ready. So I'm just going to kind of burn through that and I'll meet you back here when it's done. So now all that's left to do is cut this into the background. Tracing is lined up and then we insert this piece and line it up with the tracing. Okay, that looks pretty good. Let me just tape this down all around. So now we'll find a spot to thread the blade through. How about just down here, right where the stem goes. And now it's the same cut as before. So now we'll just glue it up to a panel the same we did in the last project and throw some finish on it. And there we have it. So let's compare this one to the one we did on the laser. So the first thing you'll notice is that I'm a little out of practice with the saw. I think yours will look better. You also notice I didn't do any sand shading on this one. You can, I just wanted to save time for the video. If you want to see the sand shading, check out the laser video. You also notice the edges of the laser cut pieces are a little more visible due to the burning of the laser. The double bevel pieces can almost blend into each other. And that's it for this one. Check out the next one where we do painting with wood on the Chevrolet. Thanks for watching. Take care.